Welcome to SiriusXM, Bob Marley's Tuff Gong Radio. Today is a very special day. In studio, we have with us none other than one of the producers of the film that you've been waiting for a very long time, Bob Marley's One Love. So welcome, Ziggy Marley. Anywhere. And we also have the lead for the film, none other than Kingsley Ben Adair. And the lady who's shown powerfully in the film, and I know you're dying to ask her questions as well, Lashana Lynch. Yeah. All right, first of all, welcome Ziggy, mm-hmm. Welcome Kingsley, welcome Lashana. It's really nice having you here at Bob Marley Tuff Gong Radio. Ziggy, you played a big role in bringing something that a lot of persons have always wanted to see come to life. How long did it take you to get this project together and get the team together?
Let's see, for finish it, 5 years in total. From start to finish now, 5 years.
I think a lot of persons were asking on social media, and they asked me as well, why did you choose Valentine's Day and not Bob's birthday to release the film?
Yeah, whenever I choose it, it just happened that way there, for work out that way there, which is, I think it's good.
Yeah.
Because we did plan it for another date, but some things happen. Everything work out how it's supposed to work out, and we accept the universe, and we listen to the universe. We don't fight the universe.
Yeah.
So this is what the universe say.
Yeah. What does the film mean to you?
Well, it means Bob message get to live in a different place and reach a different set of people and just extend the reach of the message, really. That doesn't really mean it's just another vehicle for the message, really. And my father did always want to make a movie. So he was one of them, and he read comics and he wanted to make a movie, so that's a part of it, but it's a reach of the message, really. It's expanding the reach of the message and having his idea, philosophy, live in different spaces.
Yeah. All right. Kingsley.
There's an interview I heard. It was an interview that I studied for a little while where someone asked Bob about making a movie. Mm. And he would say, I remember hearing him talking about it, saying, yeah, but it has to be this and that. And he's just talking about a movie. And then there's a line in the film where Seeker says to him, I'm going to make a movie. And he says, yeah, one day. But it came from listening to him. Bob said, I listened to a lot of Bob talking over the years and some of the conversations, the really in-depth ones, he ends up talking about really niche things that we managed to get in the film. And you don't always see them things on YouTube in the famous videos. I had the, it was a luxury, really. I had hours and hours of Bob talking, but he said he wanted to make a movie.
No. What made you audition for the film? Because those are some very big shoes to fill.
I found out that Ziggy and Sadella would be watching it the next day. Someone literally said that. They said, if you get the tape together, they're going to watch it. Yeah. So I was like, oh, all right. Let me see. This is nothing to lose, It was nothing to lose. And I always... Well, I really enjoyed that. I had a weekend, to put something together. And I spent the weekend just watching The Rainbow, Bob at the Rainbow Theatre in London. I just watched those concerts and I was listening to him. And it's just enjoyable, It's the work. It was what a treat. And I was just fascinated by him because I kind of felt like I knew him, but I didn't know him. I got him, but I didn't get him, I recognized him, I think I recognized the street guy, I recognized the guy from the ghetto, and he was just, the way he expressed himself and the way he just spoke his mind, I was like, this is an amazing character,
When you got the call, the confirmation call, did it sink in at that time that, yes, I will be playing this iconic character?
I think it was only after we spoke in LA. So, my feeling was definitely, I've gosh, I got so much work to do. There's a lot of work to do, and my head just went into what I got to do, you know. So I didn't really think of it like that. It's only really now, like maybe the last few weeks, and getting to talk about Bob and celebrate him and be around everyone and being in Jamaica. And yeah, you know, like Bob has so much love. People love him, and there's so much goodwill around him. And I guess I've only just started experiencing that, because I was in a headspace where it was just about the work and the craft and the job and trying to find his essence in the scenes we were doing, you know. And so yeah, I turned the volume down on his iconic status, because I think I would have run a mile, you know, if I didn't.
You don't sing.
Nope.
You don't dance.
Nope.
You don't play the guitar.
Nope.
How did you get ready to sink into character?
Practice and a lot of coaches. Do you remember? Do you know? I said to Ryan the other day, when I came to the studio, and it was at LA or Miami, I must have been playing the guitar for like 3 weeks. And I came to the studio, and you guys were recording some things for the film early. Mm. And I was sitting in there, and I just went, I don't know what came over me. And I just walked in, and I picked up a guitar, and I started singing Shot the Sheriff. I think Stephen was performing something beautiful, you know? And I just intruded, picked up a guitar, and started like going for it in the wrong tone, out of tune. And I guess I just thought to and Fiora, my singing teacher, was there, and she's like, what is he doing? And I guess I just figured, if I can go and do this now and with no fear, and just be like, this is where I'm at,
Then
nothing's going to be harder than just rolling up into the studio with you guys and start trying to sing. I don't know what I was on. But yeah.
Lashana, you know, I don't think they could have chosen a better actress to convey Rita Marley. I think when people look at you and see your works and see you, they just know that you, as we would say in Jamaica, she got anglet. You understand?
Yes.
How did you get yourself ready to capture and portray Rita, not as a figure in the background, but as someone by Bob's side and in the forefront, like a column, like steel? How did you get ready?
I got ready, quite frankly and brutally, by getting the director ready in the way that I needed him to be ready for the Rita that I thought I could play. And that's not to say that our director, Ronaldo Green, didn't do a brilliant job. It's that before I had the script, before I knew I had an audition, before I knew that I could possibly be in the room with everybody, I wanted to know that I was walking into a space that would celebrate Mrs. Marley, who she is as a human, who she is as a spirit, who she is to Bob, and not just, I keep using this word reduce, but sometimes in cinema, especially as Black women, we do get put in these columns, the wife, the teacher, the strong one, the bold one, the one that withstands, the one that has to always triumph at the end, even though they went through a lot, but in a really perfect way. And it's never really shaped in a narrative that made sense to me as the woman that I am. So I needed to know that going into this, I could play someone that I could protect. And I knew that Mrs. Marley was someone that our culture has protected since she's existed in our lives. So I wanted to know that as an artist, I could do that through my own artistry. So it started there. And then I got the script and I was like, okay. This is where the real work begins. We had like 7-8 months to interrogate, to talk, discuss out, and really feel what kind of story we wanted to tell. I think that it was important for me to be on the same page as Kingsley, to know that we had a certain level of ownership over the Bob and Rita that everyone is going to get to know through this movie. And I wanted the education of the real them to be truthful and authentic. I didn't want it to be characters, because, you know, it's very easy to look at a film and say, these are two characters that these actors played, but they're real people. We're embodying these people. These are true portrayals. And, you know, luckily I had Mrs. Marley open up her doors to me, and after I'd read her book and watched all the YouTube videos and scoured the internet and done all that, I sat with her and I realized that getting her spirit and her energy somewhere, harnessing it somewhere in me, would have helped me to find more of her in the days that I was confused or questioning myself, or like looking around at Ziggy and Sadella on set and being like, am I like your mom today? Is this enough? Am I on the right page? So a culmination of everything, but then remembering that these are real stories. We're not just actors coming in, playing a part. We have a responsibility to protect a culture and protect a history that is legendary and will be hopefully more legendary after everyone sees this film.
You know, yeah.
No, I know that before you met her, you had a book with questions. Yeah. But when you met her, you left the book in your bag.
Yeah.
I don't think I have heard anyone ask you, what were some of the questions?
Ooh. I mean, they span from, that's a really good question. No one has asked me that before. They span from really basic, like drama school questions, like, what was your favorite color as a child? To, what was the first thing that you thought when you saw Bob's eyes? Mm-hmm. You know, what was the, where did the love come from? Where did you feel it? How do you approach music? I wanted to know why she chose and harnessed the style that she had in the 70s. And what kind of mother she thinks she is to her children and to everybody, because she's kind of like a mom to everyone. I wanted to know what the kind of wife that she was and the kind of like maternal instincts that she had that would help her take care of a person like Bob. Mm-hmm. Because if I didn't get that right, then I knew that the whole thing would probably fall apart. For me as an artist, I just knew that that maternal side needed to kind of, I don't know, it just needed to be leveled for me to approach it in the way that I had in my head. But I'm glad that I didn't ask those questions, because there's no way I can go in her house and just say, what's your favorite color? Like, she doesn't want me to ask that, I'm sure. But I just realized they weren't necessary. Her spirit was necessary for everyone to learn her authentically in the film.
Ziggy, how did you know that Kingsley was the right actor for the role?
You just feel it. I mean, we follow our feelings. You know, you follow the truth that is within you. And when you see something that is true, you accept that truth. Mm-hmm. So when we see Kingsley audition tape, the emotional connection we had with what he was doing was strong and kept us engaged and just made us feel a connection to what he was doing. And so, you know, we just follow that, we follow the lead, you know, at the true feelings.
Kingsley and Lashana, did you meet before actually going on set? Did you have like casual meetings?
Yeah.
Did you like jump in our DMs and say, yo, Woody, we need for meet up? How did it go?
From the top.
In a roundabout way. I kind of like, I feel like I forced you to meet. It's like,
you're blushing, Lashana. What happened?
No, I was sent to meet Lashana. I thought I was auditioning for Lashana. You know?
I feel like Ziggy have something to tell me, you know? Ziggy over here scratching in the corner.
I knew everyone wanted Lashana to play the role when Lashana didn't know how much everyone wanted her. So I was like, well, I don't understand what this game going on is. She's like, by far, you know? And so I was going and trying to prove myself to her. I don't know why. And then that was really 7-8 months, you know, before we, I think it was, I don't know, March or something. And we just had a really long lead up and lots of conversations. And, you know, the thing I was going to say earlier, like, I don't know if this is like too acting talk, but you can't play an idea. Do you know what I mean? Mm. You can't play, when I say turning the volume down on an icon, turning the volume down on those kind of things, it's that you can't really, acting's not about imitating or mimicry. It, like, the best performances aren't. Like, and sometimes you get, you know, some people get lucky and they just happen to look, sound, and like visually, you know, look like someone who they're playing. And then if they find the essence on top of that, it can be doubly powerful. But really, from an acting point of view, And the same with Rita and Bob, or anyone who, you know, existed or was real. It's really, the spirit is the only thing. And the spirit really is the emotional life. And the spirit is what made them human. And that's something that we can all relate to. So for me and Bob, it was like, yeah, I don't know why I wanted to say that. It just feels like, you know, Bob is known by everyone, and the music is so powerful. And what he did and what he achieved and what he stood for. It's just been a joy to spend the last 2 years of my life getting to know him on a personal level with the people who loved him and people who were there with him. Like, it's been such a, a life-changing thing. And the culture, you know, to be surrounded by everyone from Jamaica who lifted me and supported me, and not just me, but the project. Yeah. I've never felt that kind of love on a film set before, and just really, really incredible. Sorry.
I have to also say, because you've made it about the process of the project, and I understand it because you've got so much respect for it. But the way that this man works is a different level that I've never really met before as an artist. The way that I'd come, we shared a hotel at one point and we were opposite each other, and I'd go to knock to see if he wanted to talk about something, and I would just hear constant strumming. And I'd be like, cool, he's in his pocket right now, I'm gonna leave him. And a few hours later, I'd open my door and go to talk again and he'd still be strumming. And I'm like, that coupled with the amount of work on your patois, the amount of conversations, the amount of protection for this man, the amount of upholding of the legend, the icon that we know, but also harnessing this very intimate, vulnerable, emotional side of Bob that no one's really gonna know unless you have an actor approach this person in a sensitive way. And that's not just putting the acting aside, putting the industry aside. Kingsley has embodied Bob in a way that had helped me become more Rita. There were moments on set when I thought, oh, actually, I'm able to do this more because he's literally pouring into me. And I think we do that as artists naturally if we care, but as humans who care about each other and care about the world, that's something that you can't always teach. And I think that Kingsley has that in abundance and was able to just feel things that I thought, gosh, wow, it feels like I'm there. When we were shooting the live shows and Kingsley was in his body the entire time, I thought, wow, it feels like we're at the show. This is, everyone is stressed on set, everyone. And then Kingsley's just in the middle of the stage, just vibrating away. It was just incredible to see and very, very inspiring, and made me feel more of an artist every day, truly.
Thank you.
Because of what you did.
Thank you.
Just had to be said.
All right, so you're listening to Ziggy Marley as well as Kingsley Benadir and Lashana Lynch on Bob Marley's Tuff Gong Radio on SiriusXM. Ziggy, I heard Kingsley mention that you'd brought some Rastafari elders. Why was that important to you to have them on set?
Yeah, I mean, we grew up with them, you know? Them know me from a baby. Them know my father. It's not why, I mean, it's come very natural for us to want to incorporate the real people in this thing, because we wanted it to be real. We don't want to just use actors, we want the real people with the real energy, the real vibe, who know the real culture. And so not just the Rasta elders, but the actors we brought in, we shoot in Trenchtown. It's just reeling up the thing. It just make it more real and less Hollywood. You know what I'm saying? So that was the key, because a lot of the people who acted around Kingsley and Lashana are first time, they're not really actors. And I was talking to Aston Barrett, who plays his father, family man. I was like, you are acting, you're just being you. You know what I'm saying? So the realness of that helped the film feel
more authentic.
Yeah, and be more real, you know? So we have to bring in that. And the spiritual element of the Rastafari element from these elders, because we can't do the movie without having a real spiritual element. We can't fake spirituality. It has to be real, because Bob was real and that was a real thing. And so I know that growing up as a youth. So for have the real spiritual element in the film also, the real man, them play the drum, them and know the chants. You just add that other element to it that you can't get through acting.
Which scene, when you were watching it being filmed, you looked at it and your body started vibrating differently and it brought you back to a time and you had to take a breath and do a long exhale. Which scene was that for you, Ziggy? Because I know had to be a talk to us. Let it out, Ziggy. Let it out.
No, I'm going to give you my what really. And that nice, but that's not me. Me tell you me really. The scene that me really love is a joking scene with Baba joke. With Baba, when there's the scene in the office with the guy want to understand when Kingsley say, me not this thing for my ego. Me not this thing because of a cause. And the guy was like, huh? Them thing that real, that it remind me of my father. It remind me of daddy in the humorous side of him, the kind of way where him be, his sense of humor is not always true speaking, but true, I'm gone. You know, yeah. So that really, it does remind me of my father, the humorous side of him. And it made me laugh. So that a lot of my emotional connection to the film is true laughter.
Yeah.
Not true sorrow, but true laughing, because it reminds me of my father so much. Those type of moments, those are the moments that the world don't know, but we know it. And we see it in the movie when Kingsley do it. You know what I say? So when Bob joke around, we laugh. I mean, he's a jovial man. When him there with him crew, with the band man, them, it's like, enough joke and laughter. I see it all the while.
Yeah.
So that was good to see. So that really made me, it never made me like, it made me laugh, you know, and feel joy, you know? So that was good, yeah.
All right, I'm going to ask you, this is my final question to Kingsley and Lashana. Which scenes, because I know oftentimes actors, you know, they will take on a role, but then there's always a moment in the film where you execute a scene and you go back to your hotel rooms or your trailer, you sit or you lie in your bed looking in the ceiling and like, you feel spent because everything just came out of you. What scenes did that for you, or what scene?
That was every day for me, I think. Yeah. I don't think there was one, you know, some were more different emotions in different scenes, but I think overall I made sure I don't know something about it. I was like, every beat is not, it's Bob, so every beat was as sacred as every other beat. Honestly, with true. This one.
It's true, yeah.
I think that the scene, there are a couple of scenes in the bedroom, but there's one scene in the bedroom when it just feels like the two of them their hearts are meeting in a different way. It's a very raw, open scene that kind of made me feel raw at the time, and I remember crying a lot. It's a tearful scene, but I remember genuinely crying as myself. And you've said this before, Kingsley, like sometimes you don't really know if you were crying or if it was Bob that was crying or kind of a mixture of the two. That day, I remember Ziggy were there actually that day when I came in and I was like, I just need everyone. need everyone to understand what we're shooting today. It's going to be a hard day.
Yeah.
And I could just feel from when I woke up that morning, I was like, there's just an outpouring that I feel like I'd been waiting months to do. And I got to do it in that scene. And it kind of continued after. Yes, in the trailer. Amongst many others, I think that was the kind of one of the closest that I felt that they'd got to together in the story.
All right, thank you. I have to tell you, when you first showed up in England, that scene, and Bob was sitting and he saw you, the tears just rolled out of my eyes. I was like, Jesus, this is too much. This is too intense. Mm. Before you said a word, it's very intense. I think when the audience gets to that scene, they'll understand what I'm saying. But I'm going to give the audience the opportunity to ask some questions. And first up is Courtney Lark. Courtney?
Yes. Courtney Locke from Brooklyn, New York. Okay, this question is for Ziggy. Your father, Bob, left an indelible mark on the world with his music and message. What do you believe is the most important aspect of his legacy that One Love captures, and how do you contribute to ensuing that this movie authentically represents his spirit and philosophy?
Really simple, you know, my father was a good human being, you know, that's legacy, really. I'm gonna tell the truth. It's have nothing to do with the music. The music come after the human being, not before. Everything else come after the person, who you are as a person. And so we grew up seeing him being a good human being to people. Just a humble man, love for help people, and that's the legacy. And yeah, it's not about, if him never sell one record, or if he never know one song, he would have still have the same legacy. Because people who know him, love him. Love him because of who he is as a man. Have nothing to do with the music, who he is as a person. So that is his legacy, and that is what we try, that is what we live up to, not the star, but the human being, you know, the principle, the discipline where I'm showing him work, the love where I'm showing to people, the humbleness where I'm carrying with him, you know, that's what we look upon as legacy, you know?
All right. Jason Thames?
Hi, this question is for all of you. Collaborating on a project about a figure as iconic as Bob Marley involves a great deal of responsibility and passion. Can each of you share a memorable moment from behind the scenes that encapsulates the spirit of working on this movie?
I'd say maybe the first, before we did the first take in the movie, you know, we all stood in a circle and Ziggy spoke for a minute or two, you know, and it was very, it's really powerful. Just before take one. Yeah.
Shari Burl?
Taking on the role of Bob Marley undoubtedly requires a deep connection to his music and message. Can you share a particular song or lyric of Bob Marley's that deeply influenced your portrayal and why?
It's really hard to pick one with Bob because it was over, you know, the 7 months or whatever we had in the lead up to shooting, that process didn't really stop. You know, it continued all the way through to we wrapped, you know, so it was a whole, I felt like the creating of the movie was an investigation of Bob. It was trying to constantly find the best way to interpret his spirit through me, not pretending to be him, but through me. So when I tell you honestly, I would wake up most mornings and before I put the kettle on, Bob's already playing, talking or singing or just like rough bedroom, like he's always in my ear. So I'm absorbing, I'm playing him when I'm not even consciously listening to him. So he's just always there in my head. And I don't know if that's overworking or what it is, but that's just what I did. Because of the language, you know, so it's really hard to pick one. I'm trying to think of something.
Oh, pick a few then.
Pick a few. I love there's an interview that Sadella sent me, where at some point, I think Bob forgets he's in an interview, and he ends up just really talking, you know, and. Him and the lady who's interviewing him, they really get into it, you know, and they're challenging each other. And he tells her that she needs to check her subconscious self and she should be still and listen. And when she's still and listens, then she'll understand. And I just thought it was hilarious. Like, it was brilliant. It was so profound and funny. And it kind of just, for me, was something about that. That whole interview for me is that's the one I really listen to more than anything else. It talks about everything, you know, everything. And I really feel like I got to know him in that interview, as you know, in a way. And so yeah, check your subconscious self, because it made me go, I need to check my subconscious self, you know.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Lashana, Kingsley and Ziggy, thank you so much for passing through the studios of SiriusXM on Bob Marley's Tuff Gong Radio. It was a pleasure having you, and I'm going to go watch the movie again. And I urge you and I encourage you all to go and watch it. You will not regret watching it. It's an experience. Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you.